event. Delighted to have Celia Imrie to come and talk to us. When we booked her, it was with the caveat that she might have to pull out because of other commitments. So it was a little bit of a risk, but we decided to take it, and I'm glad we did. A big problem in that Celia doesn't take her top off on a Sunday.
Acorn Antiques, the musical, and a few years back she scored an off-Broadway triumph with Stuart Permet's one-woman play, Unsuspecting Susan, about a terrorist, the mother. Proud and privileged to introduce Celia Imrie, both as a well-loved star of stage and screen, but also a great friend. Now, Celia, did you always want to be an actress?
No, I wanted to be a ballet dancer at the Mary Rudolph Nuria. I grew too big, and he had other plans. So anyway, but I'm here, and maybe if I'd been a ballet dancer, I wouldn't be. So I'm very thrilled.
And your book title reflects.
Oh yes. Does anybody know what a hoofer is? I don't know how well known it is. Because I think it's a wonderfully affectionate term, but I wasn't quite sure how well known
was
it was.
Say it in case of something.
What it is?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Well, I'm happy, and I am a hoofer, which is a chorus dancer. So I thought it was rather a good title. Unlike the Happy Hooker, which is a well-known film.
That's what she does Monday to Saturday. A journalist once asked you whether your mother went out to work, and you said no. The subsequent article in the newspaper quoted that your mother was a stay-at-home housewife. How true was that?
Completely not true. She would have screamed with laughter, actually, if she heard that. My mother was quite a toff. Well, very much of a toff, actually, although she was very modest and didn't really say quite how much she was, but never went out to work. Used to drive ambulances in the war, played her violin to old people's homes, fed the chickens, and was mostly found on either the race course or at a party. And was a glorious example and is in practically every role I play. But she certainly wasn't a stay-at-home mum. In fact, I hardly ever saw her, actually.
In fact, I did Celia's family tree. Her father's side, who is working class Glaswegian, I got back as far as him and his father in a tenement flat in the Gorbals. Her mother, I just hit in her mother's name and it went, direct descendant of William the Conqueror. And on both sides, it was the most incredible thing. This family tree, normally you just put in, you have to slave and get birth certificates, and then you get one generation back. You just put in her mother's name, and just hundreds of people from
Albemarle Bertie is my favourite.
Oh, it's a Peregrine and Albemarle Bertie. It's a great album. The Old King Cole. John of Gaunt. Troy's there. It's the most incredible family tree you've ever seen. God, actually, she can pass her thing right back to God through her mother, stay-at-home housewife. When you were a student at the Guildford School of Speech and Drama, in one a board Saturday, you went to a pub and entered a Guess the Pennies in the Jar contest.
I did. I wonder if anybody does that anymore. It was a huge, great whiskey bottle, I seem to remember, in a pub in Windsor. And I suppose they were the old pennies. I'm showing my age a bit. But anyway, you had to guess how many were in the whiskey bottle.
And miraculously, I guessed exactly right, and my prize was a blind date with Rodney Marsh. He'd had a few, so we got as far as the Lamborghini, and then he passed out. So that was my date.
Some prize, I mean. When you were first starting out, you didn't go directly into the theatre. You had a lot of, you did go directly into the theatre, age of
16.
Yeah. And you also, to make ends meet, did an awful lot of other kind of jobs.
I did.
Might you tell us some of it?
Yes. Well, one of my favourite ones actually was with the most wonderful Anita Dobson. She and I used to be Shakespearean wenches at a ghastly restaurant in Blackfriars. It was called the Shakespeare Tavern. And we were dressed up in mob caps and little frilly skirts and little frilly blouses, which we used to pull down to get extra tips. Okay, both of us did. And people could. They paid one, you know, price, so they eat as much as they like and drink as much as they like and be sick as much as they like. I just pretended it wasn't my table and ran off. I don't regret any of these things, actually. And my other favourite job was being the cleaner for a rather marvellous composer called Arthur Schwartz. I don't know if any of you remember Bandwagon and all the marvellous songs he composed. The great thing about these people were they lived in Knightsbridge and they had the most up-to-date Hoovers and everything else. They had to do too much, except one day I was, and I got this wrong on the radio the other day, I was, I said I was red bishoping. I wasn't, I was red cardinaling. I knew it was something to do with clergymen. I was scrubbing away on my hands and knees and, was, and then this very expensive stiletto heel climbed over me because all the lunch guests were arriving. Gosh, I got into trouble for that. But you know, waitressing, cleaning, all those sort of jobs that I did, I don't regret any of it.
Well, you had a very exciting bit of cleaning when you accidentally opened the wardrobe.
I did, yes. I'm not allowed to say who it is. But anyway, it was a very well-known scriptwriter and actor who's still alive, so I daren't say. Anyway, no, you work as hard as you can, and then you think, oh God, you know, and then trying to find, you know, a little less strenuous bit to do. You could do a bit of dusting, so you could go and find a duster underneath the stairs, and you could come across about 15 gilt-edged photograph frames filled with all the most glamorous actresses of the time, all in black and white. Very pretty pictures, Joanna Lumley, Kate O'Mara, all the leading actresses of the day. And every single one of them, and there must have been about 15 or 20, all the same size, all the same frame, saying, to my darling, I nearly said his name. To my darling, with love from your very own Tiger. They all were called Tiger.
On a Royal Shakespeare Company world tour, where we were both understudies. I was understudying Glenda Jackson, who just got her second Oscar, and you were understudying
Pam St. Clement. Pat.
Butcher.
Which has changed her name.
Well, 100 times probably, yes. But East End.
The darling Pam St. Clement, yeah.
And this was the most extraordinary tour. Would you like to talk a bit about it?
Well, it was, because actually I was 22, and I'd never been abroad before. Now, that doesn't sound too extraordinary, but I suppose it is in today's comparative children growing up. So I found myself on a plane to Australia, age 22, never having been abroad before. It was extraordinary, actually. I also had to make the tea. I was the tea girl. But with Glenda being so very famous, and also Timothy West, Patrick Stewart, Jenny Linden, Constance Chapman, it was a fantastic cast.
Oz Clark was the other understudy. And now on my
hand. I'm quite sure discovered the brilliance of Australian wine on that spirit.
Well, he certainly did. He used to just keep going off and saying, Tim, to Tim West, would you like to join me? I found a binary, a winery. And they'd go off and come back absolutely slazzled. And then he brought all these bottles back, and that was his new career, no longer an understudy.
Yes. But we did, I mean, I'm forever starstruck. I think I always will be. So I sort of used to hide behind the flats while all these very famous people.
Well, you had to let them in.
Yes.
When we went to Hollywood, we played in these massive theatres opposite, because Glenda at that point was the most famous actress in the world. And everybody came to see her. And Celia, our stage manager, or assistant stage manager, it was her job to escort these people from the stage door. She'd like to list a few of the people that walked through.
Oh, gosh.
Barbara Stanwyck, I remember. Greer Garson.
Greer Garson.
Gregory Peck.
Gregory Peck.
Betty Davis.
I just fell over walking backwards, looking at him. Oh goodness, George Siegel,
Walter Matthau. Yes, it was the most incredible list of people to see.
Betty Davis.
And another day, you were out with Glenda and Tim and Connie Chapman, who had just made a lot of films of David Story film plays. So she was quite well known. She was an elderly actress who was just very, very funny and camp, wasn't she? And you were all sitting in a cafe in Hollywood, and an autograph hunter came in. Could you tell us about that story?
So they went whizzing up to Glenda, of course, and asked for her autograph, and she was always very, very gracious. And then whizzing up to Tim West, who played Edward VII very recently.
Do the dialogue. What did you say? Oh my God!
Oh,
it's Glenda Jones.
Yes.
And then Ron.
Yes, but then and also to Peter Eyre, who had been in Marla, the Ken Russell films, and to Connie Chapman, who'd been in all the Lindsay Anderson films. And then suddenly they swung round to me and said, "But oh my God, you're my absolute favourite of all." Looking at me. By this time, I hadn't even done any films. You can imagine Tim, Glenda, Peter, and Connie. I think I'd sort of kept some secret. They said, "We've seen you in all those Swedish films."
In Liverpool, you played in Alfie at the Playhouse.
With the late, great Adam Faith.
Doesn't he just want to touch your heart?
I adored him, of course, as we all did. But I think you could... He'd laugh if I
stand
said...
Stand up and I can...
Well, he'd laugh if I said that he was vertically challenged, wouldn't he?
You stand up and I'll take my joke.
Okay, because in my stiletto
heels...
He was that tall. But do you remember the film? I was playing the marvellous part that Shelley Winters played, called Ruby. So, of course, I had to have high heels on, because I had to wear leather-skin slacks, and I had to have a dusty Springfield blonde beehive, naturally. So I was very, very much taller, even than usual. And in my flat, which was beautifully...
On stage.
Ruby's flat was beautifully decked out in 60s style. You know, some ghastly leather sofa, and sort of, I think it was pink wallpaper. And then I had a shelf behind the sofa with all the sort of period knickknacks of the time, including one of those ghastly flamenco dancers, you know, a pink lacy Spanish dance, a swishy skirt dress, and, you know, the dolls, and castanets, and those little pointy feet they have, like pink chopsticks, pointy. Anyway, this particular night, Adam got rather amorous and threw me back on the sofa, which was the usual thing to do, except this was much harder than usual this night. Gave me a good old snog, and he was very good at it. Turned to the audience to do his monologue, his alpha monologue, to say, didn't I do well this time? And as he was, as I clambered to my feet, I got the most, I stood up and got the most enormous laugh. And I thought, gosh, this didn't happen. And I suddenly realised that Adam was sort of looking up at me, more usually, rather curiously. And what I didn't realise is that the dog had fallen off the shelf, embedded herself in me.
Saying, you better get this right or you'll make a real fool of yourself. So I had to start from scratch, and in fact we got it so good that even people in Glasgow hadn't got a clue what we were talking about.
It was in England it came out with subtitles.
Because in Aberdeen, handbag becomes handbag, and going is game. But whatever you do in an Aberdonian accent, don't ever ask anyone to sack your pianist. And neither was I looking that we were going completely the opposite direction to the film location. And this was very worrying. It turned out that he was from the Pictish Society. And I still don't know what they do or what
they do. It's an ancient society that believes that they have to have retribution against English people.
Yes.
And that it is their duty to abuse women or something. kidnap women. Abduct and kidnap women.
I think they were upset because it was English people filming a Scottish Highland story. But boy, oh boy, I did a marvellous piece of sort of Avengers escape, I think. In the end, we came to a traffic light, thank goodness, when I realised I was miles out of the way. And opened the door and sort of rolled out, you know, action style, and managed to get back. But it was very hairy. And I sometimes I think I dreamt it, but I absolutely didn't.
Now, I've said that you were in this film, The House of Whitwater, but I could talk a little bit about that. And then I will then also talk about being on stage at the National with Dame Judi Dench.
Yes. Well, I love the title of The House of Whitcourt, because whenever I say it, you can see people's faces going, you know, because it sounds a bit dodgy, doesn't it? Well, it was a soft porn film when I was 17. So, actually, it was a marvellous story, wasn't it?
Well, I had to study it at university in a course which I did at Birmingham called Violence, and we'd begun with ancient Greek, Seneca, the medieval mysteries, through into the Jacobeans, through into Victorian melodrama, through into things like Straw Dogs, and The House of Whitwood.
But it's a marvellous thing to put on your theatre credits, you know, after Ibsen, Shakespeare, and everything else. And I always leave it to the end, and The House of Whitwood. And this, now we cut to when I was at the National Theatre with the great thrill of working with Dame Judi Dench, who you cannot get a laugh out of ever. and she and I were asked to go to an understudy rehearsal. And I can remember I was having, by the way, can everybody hear okay? I can hear, can you not hear? At all? Or some bits? Some bits. I'll just shout out if you can't, please, because I meant to say that at the beginning. And I was having a rather lovely lunch in St. James's on this particular day, and the understudies had asked us to go and watch them, which I thought was rather brave of them, actually, to have Dame Jude in the audience. Anyway, I wondered when I was having my lunch, I wonder if Dame Jude will go. But anyway, I said, I had got a pang of conscience, so I rushed across London and I got there. There she was. That's the sort of person she is. She was there in the audience. But it was the first time that she could read the programme, because she never has time to do that, and came up to me at the end of the rehearsal and said, what's this? House of Whitcourt? What's that mean? What's the word? And in very cross face. And I said, calm down, it was just a soft porn film I made when I was 17. By the way, this is, I'm afraid to say, now about 30 years ago, okay? Blow me down if the next time we did The Sea, which was probably about 3 weeks later, 3 days later, we have a little bit, what they call upstage, while somebody else, poor Sam West, was trying to do a scene downstage, and we were upstage.
And I should point out the set was white. Everything on it was white. There was a white table with white plans all laid out, and Judy and Celia at the back.
And amongst the white plans at the back, there was a square box, you know, about the size of my hand, but it was square, and it was done up in white paper. And Judy kept pointing at it to me, and I didn't know what she was on about. She kept pointing at it, and in the end she said, this is in the middle of somebody else's scene. Anyway, I opened it, and there was a very garish videotape of The House of Whitwood.
Merchant of Venice.
I did. As a matter of fact, we'd done India and we were now in Pakistan, and I was playing Nerissa, the maid, not Portia, which I'd love to play, but I wasn't. I was playing Nerissa, the maid, the small part. And the driver was very excited welcoming the new company to Pakistan and said, would you like to go to see the theatre where you're going to be opening tomorrow night? Because the artist has done a huge picture of your leading lady on the front of the theatre. So we said, oh, it's okay. So we all bundle them in the back, and they're quite long.
And the, I don't know if you've seen any Indian cinemas in England, they do them there as well. They're the most incredibly coloured things. They're like go-go, all in purple.
Usually pink and
orange,
green, actually, the faces are. You know, like the Indian posters for films. And so we all bundled, we were really bundled in the back of this big lorry. We had quite a long journey through the dusty streets and got out onto the country of this rather lovely theatre. We turned the corner, and there in front of us was the theatre that we were going to open in the next day, and there was this huge big picture of the leading lady, but it wasn't. It was me. And I was really playing the maid, and then got it wrong. Can you imagine? The leading lady was sitting right beside me. I can still remember the smoke coming out of her ears. It wasn't my fault.
How did you get your part in Star Wars?
Oh, yes. Somebody asked me that the other day. Our life is so bizarre. But strange enough, I was in a. I had the great honour of being in a play with Harold Pinter called Hot House, in which he was starring and was brilliant. And in the audience was a casting director for George Lucas. And I was doing, you know, rather a serious part, I thought.
But that was true, wasn't it?
Why? Actually, I can't remember. I don't really know what I was. I was so frightened of Harold, actually, who was a darling, but I wasn't quite sure, you know, a lot of some of the things I had to say. However, it was quite serious. But there in the audience was the casting director who took one look at me and thought, she'd be good as a fighter pilot in Star Trek. So there I am, bravo for him. Very proud.
Have much connection with Mr. Lucas?
No. Well, you see, I lie rather well, apparently. and on the first day, you have to understand, I've never seen a Star Wars film in my life, so I have no clue what's going on. But I pretended on the first day when I was driven out to this huge set, and George Lucas was there, and I said, oh, I'm so excited. This is so thrilling. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited. That's what he replied. That was all. And the next connection I had with him is because I was dressed up in goggles and a helmet and a rather fetching orange jumpers. So I thought I'd put some orange lipstick on. Take it off. The word came down from Mr. Lucas didn't want lipstick on his Star Wars fighter. I still, to this day, don't know who I shot at, whether I
shot at. Anyway, I'm rather fascinated by it because Celia tells me that, like in Shakespearean England, they were never allowed to see the whole script because he's so neurotic about the stories getting out that you're only sent your lines and the cue. So, of course, nobody can have a clue because you're not allowed to see it. You had another adventure in space, this time with Mrs. Sylvester Stallone.
Ah, yes, who's rather gorgeous, actually. Bridget Nielsen, who is an Amazonian beauty with the most beautiful skin. And she's rather fun, and we discovered we had the same birthday.
And you'd all probably recognise her if you happen to have seen her on Big Brother recently. She made
Do you know who I'm talking about?
Yes. Tall, blonde, yeah.
Very tall, blonde. With, so she and I were in space in a film called Murder on the Moon. Or as Davis's gorgeous mother had rang up and said, that should have been called Murder on Earth if you bothered to watch it. She's absolutely right. But anyway, at this point, we had to, because we were in space, we had to be weightless, obviously, and go around and fly, which I'd always wanted to do, actually. So we got strapped up, you know, they put straps sort of round here and round your waist, so that you can fly horizontally in, you know, any direction you wanted. So at this point, Bridget
and they tried the men of the set. The men on the set had all tried it all out that morning and got it all set up ready for the two women to come in and do it.
So they were understudying. Can you see all right? And so it was our turn next. So we stood opposite each other. We got our straps on, and we were going to face each other, and then have to be flown away from each other like that, horizontally. So we got into our positions, we were well strapped up, and they said, okay boys, take them up. So very gradually we went like this, we got horizontal, and then we came up. And they said, no, we're going to have to wake their ankles, because we both had
a few years back, you had a great success in the West End, playing Sybil Thorndyke, she wasn't Dame, I think, at that point in the play, but she, Dame, who we know as Dame Sybil Thorndyke, in a play about John Gielgud and the scandal of him being caught cottaging.
Yeah.
Did you enjoy that? You played another part in that, actually.
I played two parts, because I'm so greedy, and the second part was to play a nightclub owner called Vera. In those days, actually, the women often did run, you know, real business women, and they ran the nightclubs for, you know, maybe homosexual men or people that, you know, it's all a bit undercover. But they were smart cookies. And in this particular costume, I, for some reason, I'm not quite sure why, but anyway, I was dressed up in a sort of 30s, 20s costume, I suppose.
I think it was because she was one of those characters who'd been very successful in the 20s and never
stayed.
Got out of the clothes.
That's right. So I was dressed in this rather shapeless, orange dress with a bandana, and an orange little bob, orange wig. It was a little bob, so it was marvellously unlike Sybil Thorndyke. But it was a rather pretty little bob with a bandana and a 20s dress. And in the company, we had a very handsome young actor called Simon Dutton, who actually was son-in-law to Lord Olivier. Very handsome. And I caught him looking at me in the wings one day. And he was saying, I know who you remind me of. I've got it. I know you. And of course, I was naturally hoping he was going to say Sophia Loren or Marilyn Monroe or one of those Marvel stars. And somebody else is trying to do a scene, by the way. And he said, I know who you remind me of. I've just got it. I'm just trying to remember the what's in it.
Rodeo Drive, which I'd only ever read about, not
been there. So off we both went in a lunch hour, and it was quite, I mean, for heaven's sake, you could buy a five-bedroomed house in Putney for a hairpin there. Really, everything is so expensive. But amongst the shoppers were noticeably quite a few people rushing around in their lunch hour in some blue-green operation scrubs. So we thought, well, we must be near a hospital, I suppose, because they had the little hats on and the, you know, the back-to-front overalls. There were many of them running up and down getting their sandwiches and everything. But actually, it wasn't a hospital nearby. I then discovered what it was, that practically every doorway had about two or three gold plaques, and they were all plastic surgeons. I mean, there must have been 32,
30. More than that. Some of the doors honestly had brass plaques up like that, sort of 50 on one door. But at this moment, when we made this astonishing discovery of, God, every single building along here has got 20 plastic surgeons working inside. An automatic door swung open.
And I looked to the side, and out came this woman, pushing her Zimmer frame in front of her, with this face on. She didn't have any wrinkles. She was probably 107. No wrinkles at all.
What are you doing next?
Oh yes, I'm going to be on the Titanic next. We've got to go to Budapest to film. I think they must have some great big water tank there, because Budapest has the hot sea.
Anyway,
it's Lord Fellows' new four-part series, and I play a lady called Grace Rushton, who is in trade from the north of England, but she is in first class. But she's the sort of person that if you heard her running down the deck behind you, you'd all go, she's one of those. But anyway, it should be great fun, and I saved my Pekingese and myself.
So I'm right. Oh, you said it.
Yes, I said.
We give the end away now. Connection that we both have. Celia, we both went together to see the Titanic exhibition recently that was at O2, and on the bottom of the programme it suddenly says, Imrie. And it turned out that one of Celia's, on her father's side, hooray, something more for that bit of the family tree, was to do with the White Star Line.
I think the Imrie sold it to the
William
Ismay,
yes.
Who then cut the corners, and thereby the disasters happened.
So he died, I think, quite a long time ago. Yeah.
It's a marvellous exhibition. Has anybody been at O2? It's ever so good.
And I also had my great 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 uncle was a Liverpudlian steward on the ship. He got off too. Typical Liverpool scallies, you know. very like my father, I tell you, he'd have got off. Men, women, and children got a beard, he'd have been off there. At the end of your book, you say that when you get home from India, you're going to tidy your house. Did you?
Still doing it.
I asked that because I knew the answer.
Yes.
Now, so I'm going to ask you two more, just rather more bizarre questions before I open it to the floor. One of which is, ballet dancers, singers, and actresses famously have desserts named after them. There was Pavlova, Crepe Suzette, Harebell Helene, Peach Melba. If you were to be epitomized in a dessert, what ingredients would a chef need?
Gosh, well, it'd have to be ice cream. Coffee ice cream, I think, is my favorite. Probably none of these things would go together. I love anything to do with meringue. I love lemon. Rather disgusting mixture. anything sort of light and fluffy. Actually, I love those things that you have a long spoon for. Don't you? Sunday. You know, yeah, Sunday.
So coffee and meringue Sunday. With a hot chocolate sauce?
Yeah, go on.
And the other one is, if you were a cocktail, what would you be? Well, and would you have an ornament, you know, cherry, olive, onion?
Well, no, because they go up your nose, don't they? You've got a stick in them. but I love something with champagne. I'm afraid I absolutely love champagne. Well, I think it was Lord Olivier's favourite, and it is a fantastic mixture. The black velvet, you know, the Guinness and the champagne together, it's rather wonderful. Yes, I'm not mad on spirit, so it would have to be something. And I love
some fruity.
Yes, maybe, you know, with black currants or something like that. That's one. I've got to think of an original one.
Yes, you've got to think of that before we do anything again.
Shove it with a kiwi fruit in. Disgusting.
Right, have any of you got any questions that you'd like to put to Celia?
Yes.
Are there any parts or actors that you haven't worked with who you would like to?
What's your first name?
David.
David's asked me, are there any parts or actors that I'd still like to work with? There's masses. I'm not going to say what, because I think it spooks it a bit. But there's, honestly, this is the danger of writing a book, which I love doing. But I promise you it's not the end, and I say that at the end, it's only the beginning. So, lots, David. Yes?
Have you got a nice parallel story you could tell us with Victoria Wood and Julie Wharton?
Well, do you know, the most difficult... Did everybody hear the question? The most difficult thing about working with, particularly Julie, actually, is how on earth do you keep a straight face? The waitress sketch, which I absolutely love. And sometimes I watch it back, and we never, never got through it in rehearsals, not in the mind. Because the thing is, we knew how long it was going to take. So, inside my mouth is blood. But it was great fun. It was enormous fun, as you can imagine. And because we knew each other well, we could work much faster, and it could all be very fun. So, not really scurrilous, but just fun.
Anyone from this side? Oh, yes. There's one up there.
Yes.
Following on from the question about Victoria Wood, have you got anything else planned with Victoria Wood? Have you on the TV or the stage?
Not at the moment, but she's, as you know, a powerhouse of writing and is branching out into all sorts of films and different things, maybe with different people, I don't know. If she asked me, of course I would, absolutely, but she's got lots of... She works so hard, she's always got something else planned. But yes, if she asked me, of course I would. Absolutely.
We so enjoyed your acting. I'm wondering whether you sing. I mean, what about, you know, Libro Mamma Mia?
Well, I don't know how honest I dare be here. I love singing, as a matter of fact. I'm not trained at all, and I did have a wonderful song to sing in Acorn Antiques, which I absolutely loved. But you know, I've never seen Mamma Mia on stage, and I saw the film the other day. I thought Meryl Streep, she can do no wrong in my eyes. I thought she was absolutely wonderful, but I didn't quite get the rest of it. Now, that's I really didn't. I didn't know what they were all doing. So honest, but so that wouldn't be my first choice. But anything else?
Well, I think Celia should be very good as May. Aren't you May to do the Jerry Herman musical?
I'd love to, love to. Yes.
Have you ever done anything that involved dancing with your initial ambitions?
Yes. Well, have I done anything that involved dancing? Really, to get me going, I was a chorus girl for a long time. You know, chorus girl in pantomimes or chorus girls in musicals. My first role was as a rat in Dick Whittington. But I looked at the programme the other day when I was writing the book, and I also discovered I was a sausage.
Sorry?
Not since you were a megastar.
Well, yes, she danced in Acorn Antiques the musical.
I did. Wow. Yes. Tap danced. Yes.
And she was excellent playing the part of Hortense in The Boyfriend. Really, really superb as that, and that's a lot of dancing.
What a friend.
What advice would you give to me? My son is 16 and is a great thespian and loves acting. What advice would you give me to give him?
Gosh. Does he want to act?
Yes.
He does.
Yes. Yeah.
And is he doing A-levels at the moment?
He'll be doing his GCSEs next year.
Yeah.
And he's just been pickering in Pygmalion at the local school.
Wow. Well, I would never put anyone off, yeah. But you do have to tell him you do have to want to do it or die.
Yeah. He knows that there's a possibility of a lot of wrestling.
Not the possibility, the certainty. The only person who's ever been out of work is Judy Dench. Yeah. Yeah. Maggie Smith had 2 years out, and she was so desperate for work, she had to move to Canada to get it, working in local reps and things. Glenda Jackson got no work for, after 2 Oscars, got no work forever and ended up doing rep and then giving up, you know. Really, I don't know anyone, do you?
No. So it's just a question of persevering and having a proper career, going off to do a degree, but doing it in your spare time.
No. He's got to put his everything into it. It's no good having it in his spare. Is that what you're saying? He wants to do it in his spare time.
He wants to do it as a career, basically. But he knows that it's better. He's been for film auditions in the past. It's just a question of just persevering and going for absolutely everything.
Well, the thing is, I mean, I never went to university, so I'm actually rather overawed by being here in this hall and in this town. It's a big thrill for me. And I think that university is ever such a good thing for a young man. But the point is, what will he study in university? Does he know?
Possibly PPE.
What?
Possibly politics.
Yep. But if he wants to really do it, he has to really do it. There's absolutely no point in doing it in his spare time. Right. You know, he's got to put everything into
You've
it.
Also got to know that you do it and you're going to A, be out of work all the time and you won't get any money or you won't get it, you know, you just won't be able to keep a family. And you will have to, if you get work in the provinces in rep, yeah. You will have to live in conditions that honestly nobody else will put up with.
And tell him not to tell you.
Read Celia's book.
But read it in the book. It's actually
in the book. She talks about one of her flats, which I was in the same company, and I know that flat was that everybody else in the building was a curry house on the ground floor, and everybody else was a prostitute.
Yeah.
It was a top floor, 6 floors. You had to walk up. There was no bath, no shower, no anywhere to wash. There was a sink in the kitchen, which was the bedroom, which had one tap, which was cold, which when it froze, there was no water. And for that, it cost about something like £200 a week.
But the thing
because is... Because as actors, they don't want you because you're there on a short contract.
But if he really wants to do it, he'll do it.
Yeah.
So I wish him luck.
I must admit, I'm a great believer.
There's another question over here.
Yeah.
Well, the exotic marigold is. Oh, I haven't told you what it's called, have I? No, did I say it?
Yes, you did.
Did I?
What is what it was about?
A marvellously catchy title, The Best Exotic Marigold Hotel, which is all set in India, and it has the two marvellous dames, Dame Maggie and Dame Jude, in it. Bill Nye, Tom Wilkinson, Penelope Wilson, Ronald Pickup, and that gorgeous young boy, Dev Patel. Who runs this hotel?
And it's Slumdog Millionaire.
Yeah. But you knew that, didn't you?
Everyone thinks she's nice.
Anyway, I play a grandmother. Far too late. Her name's Madge and she wants a husband, another husband, why not? So there are seven characters who, on the internet, find this marvellously run-down, dilapidated old hotel in Udaipur in India, run by Dev Patel. And it's an alternative to the rather grimness of what might be for the rest of their life. And they all, in their individual ways, think, why not? Let's go, let's see. And so we all come, there's a marvellous shot of us all in the airport, not knowing each other, but we all eventually end up in the hotel and you'll see what happens. It's a wonderful, wonderful story.
And who directed it?
John Mann, the marvellous John Mann from Shakespeare in Love. So I can't believe my luck, and all because I had a wonky hairdo. Yeah.
Was there a trigger that made you write a book?
Do you know, the trigger was somebody said, do you want to write a book? And I thought, because I'm, strangely enough, believe it or not, quite secretive, I thought, oh, I don't know, actually, because I have been quite honest, and I have got into trouble for it, of course. And then I thought, well, one day I will. And then I thought, wait a second, one day is now. I might not have another one day. So it was a lovely thing to be asked to do, and I've done it. Now you've got to buy it. Yes?
I just wondered if there was any conflict between the publicly facing self and the private self, because you hear so much about comedy and depression and Spike Milligan and people. You talked yourself about, you know, the time you spent waiting for that phone call and moving the hairdressers to be active as an actress again. But is there a conflict between the private and public self?
I suppose so, in a way. I mean, certainly comics, I think, sometimes are expected to tell jokes all the time, and actually that's the last thing they want to do. And you do have highs and lows, there's no question, because the highs are very high, and sometimes the lows are very low, I'm afraid. And
that's not like an awful song, sorry.
Never seen a more beautiful girl. I had the great thrill of doing Darling Buzz May with her. And you think, well, how can she be depressed? But, you know, she's had a hell of a year, poor darling, looking after her husband and getting him through that trauma. And so...
I think the difference is that she's been looking after her husband and having that trauma, whereas most people would be allowed to do that and look awful. She has had to maintain looking beautiful, yeah. So that's where you get this sort of thing that goes wrong and unhinges people. And the same, what you were saying about comedians. I remember we went out for a curry somewhere once in the Isle of Wight, and Cannon and Ball, was it them or Nithin and Large? Yes. I can't tell the story. Some people apparently meant to be funny. Place having to sort of throw pecoras at each other and go, I don't care, oh God, I don't want to. And actually I was thinking, shut up. But most people do want them to be like that. So that I think it must be terrible, because you're never allowed to be down if you're a comedian. And the minute you go to like what a normal person is, everyone will say, my God, how depressed they are. Because they're expecting this thing that's up here. I don't think we're any more or less depressed than anyone else, but we're just in a very, very dodgy
life. More visual, I suppose. Yeah. So that's, I think,
have we any questions over this side? You've been awfully left out.
Are there any parts that you turned down that you later wish to be done?
I'll say that out loud, because I'm not... Were there any parts that Celia turned down that she later wished she'd done?
Not really, actually, is the truthful answer, because more it would be if I missed out on a part and I would be sad, but then the chances are something else might come along that would meant I couldn't have done the next bit, which, you know, you turn it into your favourite bit, I think.
It's very funny when people do, lots of people say, I could have played that part of the King's Speech. But it doesn't necessarily mean then it would have got 10 Oscars. My cousin is the fabulous Linda LaPlante, who's so famous for writing television shows. She was a brilliant actress. And Willie Russell asked her to be the first ever... Shirley Valentine. The first ever Shirley Valentine. And afterwards I said, did you regret saying no to Shirley Valentine? She said, no, no. If I'd done it, it would have been a flop. Do you know, and so you have to think that, I think, to be sane. But there are nutters around who think that because somebody got 10 Oscars with someone else, it would have done with them and it might not have done.
There was another lady
yes, over there.
Not what do I prefer, film or stage? The thing about being on stage is like you get on the horse and nobody can stop you until you get to the winning post, which is marvellous, or not. I went to see myself in the Woody Allen film the other day, and my favourite scene was not there. My favourite scene with Anthony Hopkins, gone. Nothing to do with me, you see. So you're much less in control in a film, but you sort of love the thing you're doing at the moment, I think, really. And I have to tell you, first of all, you've been the most fabulous audience, and this is the first time I've done this sort of thing, so I'm absolutely thrilled. Thank you. Because do I like making people laugh? Yes, I do. Absolutely, because your laughing is like giving me an audible thumbs up, so it's heaven. That's not to say that I don't want to be very serious sometimes. Anybody else who's listening?
Just one of Celia's favourite parts I do know was in Ruth Rendell's A Dark Adapted Eye, which you couldn't get more grim than that. She plays the woman who has to actually be hanged. There's a question over here.
How did you get the part in Nanny McPhee? That's one of my favourite films.
Well,
Nanny McPhee, how did you get the part in Nanny McPhee?
I suspect very often with these big films, you're perhaps not first choice. And I happen to know I wasn't. But boy, did I make up for it.
And there's a story about the American children were shown Nanny McPhee as a part of, you know, they do this sort of trial run thing with films. And would you like to tell the end of that?
Well, when I went to my costume fitting, I said to the designer, don't make me have too low cut of blouse because I'm going to be cavorting on the floor with Colin Firth. But the thing is, it's a children's film, so, you know, we've got to look out. Anyway, so he said, yes, okay. But the director came along to look at the costume and said, oh, no, come on. And he pulled it right down. So, you know, I worked, well, mind you, it fitted the character very well to have a low cut. Blouse. I don't know if anybody saw it, but she's a marvellous sort of, you know, on the make girl. Marvellous, I loved her. But anyway, when they showed the film to the American children in the US, they, of course, had never seen moving bosoms before.
The film has tarantulas, worms, these children were terrified of Celia's bosom. Spent £250,000 or dollars, I'm not quite sure, airbrushing them out. So the children wouldn't be frightened. On that note, I'm going to thank you all for coming. We have
one more question.
Oh, just one more question, sorry.
Are you tempted to direct yourself?
Do you know, I never say never. And I think it could be rather marvellous. I've done one-to-one at the Actors' Centre with young students who are doing auditions, and that's been quite thrilling, so never know.
Now we're heading off to... Where are we heading off to?
We're heading off to the bookshop.
We're heading off to the bookshop, where Celia will be signing copies of Happy Hoofer. I've also brought a couple of my novels, Historical Crime.
Wonderful books on the screen.
Yeah, we're all working on it actually. It's been going on for some time with Paul O'Brady and various other people to get them on. But see you in
thank you very much. So just
remains again to remind you, book signing is in the bar, books are in the bookshop, and please join me in thanking them for